So this is lecture number 7 and today I will be actually doing the DC machine also a little bit portion. So this was the example and over here, and if you, I don't know how many of you have gone through this example over here. This is a simple, you can call it as a transformer or a simple core, and this core is being energized by a source over here which is going to produce a BT of 1.5 sine omega t. 1.5 is the peak over here. Sine omega t is actually certainly over here the sinusoidal waveform. Omega over here, since this is a 50 hertz, so this is going to be 377 radians per second. The number of turns are 200. And the one thing which has to be taken into account is this, that, so the all dimensions are in inches over here. So first of all, thing very important, whenever you have something like this, please, okay, so whenever you have something like this, you have to first of all convert it into your millimeters or centimeters or whatever you want to have it. Since you all know 1 inch is equal to 25.4 mm. So over here, 1 inch over here, converting it into meters and then converting it into your meter square for 1 square inch over here. So this is your 1 square inch. And then you have also the area also, because area is going to be under question also. So this is 2 over here. This is also 2 over here. So this is 2 × 2. This will be 4 square inch. So 4 square inch converted into over here. Let's come back. No problem. So you have this as a 4 square inch over here. And actually, this is a DC motor. I brought it over here today so I can show you this one. So over here you have this, why this is not working? Isko off karke dobara on karo please. Isko off karke dobara on karo. Isko off karo, iska button off karo. Isko on karo zara. Ye kyun masla kar raha hai bar bar? Turn it off. We'll shut down soon. Just wait and don't press it, don't press it. Press again. नहीं उसी इनपुट आउटपुट बटन को दोबारा प्रेस करो. इसके बाद एक दफ़ा प्रेस किया it won't again. So you have it over here that BT is equal to 1.5 sine omega t, your n is equal to 200, and I told you last time also that stacking factor is 0.94. stacking factor actually is telling you that how many how much area is being taken up by the actual laminations over here. Okay, so the mass density is given in centimeter cube. So that's why I have taken this one as 1 cubic inch equal to 2.54 cube centimeter cube. Okay, the first thing first over here, it has been asked that what is the applied voltage. Now applied voltage, I'm going to solve this one over here. This is a, come on, this is working exactly fine. Okay, so EMF is asked. So if I have been asked your E of t, so E of t would be equal to n d phi by dt. Now we know n is equal to 200, but for your phi t, we all know this is equal to B of t into area of the core over here. Now area of core is constant, it's not variable with respect to time. So you just have B of t. Now what is B of t? We all know B of t is equal to 1.5 sine omega t. So this means that for B of t, I can write it as 1.5 sine into 377 of t. So this is my B of t. And as far as the area is concerned, that is the cross-sectional area. As I told you, this is going to be equal to 2 over here. And 2 is the depth because this is 2 over here. So this means 2 × 2. So this is over here 2 × 2. So this is means that this is equal to 4 square inch. Now I want to convert this into meters. So I know inch is equal to 1 square inch is equal to 6.4516. So this means that 4 into 6 point, let me just confirm it again. This is 6.4516 into 10 raised to power minus 4. This will be meter square. So what I have now over here, that I can now put everything in my ET formula. ET n is equal to 200 multiplied by, I have to take the derivative of what equation? That equation over here would be equal to B of T, which will be equal to 1.5 sine 377T multiplied by 4 into 4 into 6.4516 into 10 raised to power minus 4. I hope I have not done any mistake. Please point out if there is some mistake done over here. See, anyone with calculator, please give me the answer. This is really 200 multiplied by this 377 will be taken out. So this will be 377. And here it will be 1.5 into 4 into 6.4516 into 10 raised to power minus 4. This is sine, so this will be converted into cos of 377t. So this is your E of t over here. Gee, please, anyone with calculator, multiply it. We did this in the last lecture, but I'm just repeating it because we could not complete this one. Gee, please, this has to be something 274 point something. Gee. Yes. Gee, please, come on, yaar. Kya ho gaya? Please have a hands-on experience on using your calculators. There will be a lot of numericals in your midterm or final. So you should be very fast on this so that you can actually arrive at an answer. Come on, please. 2? Are you sure? 291. Achha, sorry, one thing. I have missed one thing. Sorry. You have to have AC multiplied by 6.4516 into 10 raised to power minus 4 multiplied by the stacking factor, 0.94. The actual area is going to be 0.94. So you have to multiply this whole by 0.94. So this is being multiplied by 0.94. What is the answer then? 200? 60? 274.35. But okay, two significant digits are okay after that decimal. So this is going to be cos 377t. So this is your E of t. Okay, so A part is complete. You have found out the applied voltage that was applied over here. So you now you have the value of the applied voltage that is over here. So in your exam, if a question asks to draw the current waveform or the flux waveform and also the voltage waveform, it's quite easy because you know what is your B of t, that will be a sine wave with a peak of 1.5. And if it is asked you that please draw ET, then it will be a waveform with a peak of 274.35 and it will be a cosine wave. So there is going to be a phase difference between E of t and B of t, which will actually be the same as like as I of t or flux of t. Okay? So this is E of t. The second portion of this question is actually asking us that what is the peak current I max. Now whenever the peak current is being asked over here, your peak current I max is certainly going to be linked up with something related to your H max, which means that what is the value of your H at that current which is flowing over there. Now what is H max over there? We know H is equal to Ni by Lc according to Ampere's law. So if I want to convert this one into my H max, so this means corresponding to this H max, I will have to multiply N by I max divided by Lc. So this is my formula which I have to use. Now for this purpose, I need to find out Lc. Now if I go back on my diagram and I zoom in over there, what is my Lc? Lc is this pink color path over here. So if you see very closely over there, I'm not going to mark on this one. This distance is going to be equal to, this is 8, So this will be 8 minus 1 minus 1. So this will be 6. And similarly, this will be also 6 over there. And as far as this distance is concerned over there, this will be 10 minus 1 minus 1, 8. So this means your LC is going to be equal to 6 plus 8 plus 6 plus 8. Actually, simply it's over here. So this is 28 inches. And if you convert your inches into your LC in meters, this is going to be 0.7112 meters over here. So now you have LC over there. Now when you have LC over here, this is very important. You know L over here. Do you know Hmax? In this formula, what is the unknown quantity? Unknown quantity is Imax. I need to find out Imax. N I know 200. LC I know this is 0.7 something meters. I want to find out Hmax. Now how I am going to find out Hmax? Now H and B, they both are related according to the material curve over there, which is given over here. Now in the statement of the equation, you know B is equal to 1.5. So this means that the peak value of flux density is 1.5. So from that curve corresponding to that 1.5, you can find out what is H. I'm again repeating. Since you know B is equal to 1.5, this is the peak value of your sine wave or B over here. So 1.5 is going to be the peak value of B max. So over here, when I have it, so B max is going to be equal to 1.5. So certainly Tesla. And corresponding to this, I am going to find out H max from my curve, that is the BH curve of your material. Now this material, as given in the statement, is an M5 grain oriented silicon steel. So this means if I go back on this diagram over there, this is the same curve for your BH curve. Now if you see over there, I have drawn the three lines over there, or three tangents over here at different point. One is at 1 Tesla, other one is taken, I have taken at 1.5 Tesla, the other one I have taken at 1.8 Tesla. Now the reason of actually making it, now listen this very carefully. Our requirement is 1.5, so if you see over 1.5, this comes out to be something over here. So this will be something 10, this will be 20, this will be 30, this will be 40, and this will be 50, and so on up till there. It's a logarithmic scale over there. So over here, between 30 and 40, it's not exactly in the center. So it's totally up to you. You want to take something 36, 37. This error can be there whenever you are seeing such graph over there. So according to your book, they have taken it something 36 ampere turns per meter. But even if your exam, you have this figure with you and you take 37, no issues. It's totally a human error over there. Now, the point actually over here to understand over here is this, that when I had 1.5 Tesla, I had 36 ampere. This means the H value. But if my flux density was at 1 Tesla, my B was just equal to 10 ampere turns per meter. And if I had chosen 1.8, I would be somewhere like 100, 200, 300, 400, near 500 ampere turns. The manufacturer of this question over here took B at 1.5. Is this the best available point or not? This can be a question added in this. G. Is this the best available point from the BH curve which you can use over here for your material? Aapke material ka curve, your material curve is something like this over here. So either blue one is the best, green, red is the best, or the purple or pink color is the best. G. Again, sorry. Red hoga, why? Okay, one logic is this, that okay, at your red color point, the saturation is almost kicked in. Because over here, if you see very closely, here the slope is different, like this blue color line, slope is actually a tangent to the curve. And over here, this is something like this over here. And as I'm reaching the red color point, this is my slope over here. And when I'm reaching the pink color point or the purple color point, so four different points, four different slopes. And if you want to really find out the slope, you are actually going to find out mu r. What is mu r? Mu r is equal to, we know B is equal to mu naught mu r h. So this means mu r will be equal to mu naught h over here. So now, supposingly, I want to first of all find out at 1.0 Tesla. So I will put in over here 1.0 Tesla divided by whatever the value of mu naught and put in the value of h as 10. This will give me mu r of the material at this point. Then I want to find out another one. I will get another value of mu r here for different values of v and h, and I will get another value of mu r here. Now tell me, which mu r will be the highest? G, the blue one, red one, or the purple one? Blue one. Why? Because the slope is the highest at that point. Now, this may intrigue you that you should design your material at the blue color point, because the slope is the maximum. You are getting the maximum return. Aapne H add karna in your material, which means you have to add a magnetic field intensity, and you are getting the maximum B from there, because mu R is the maximum. But the problem would be that if you had fixed your B at 1.0, this means that you would require more amount of the material over there, because now you know your flux is equal to B dot A. So now if your B is small, you would have to have more value of flux, and for that maybe you will have to increase the number of turns. So you will not be getting at the maximum point. So it's a trade-off in any machine design or anywhere, that you have to first of all see the value of B also. It is not going in the saturation. And secondly, you are also not having a large area being used over there for the core, because that will increase the cost. Either the cost of the core or either the cost of the winding over here. Because if you want to increase the value of flux, what you will do? You will increase the value of current flowing, which is understandably going to increase because of the value of voltage, or you are going to increase the number of turns N over there. Increasing the number of N turns means certainly the cost of copper is increased, and certainly the workmanship. So this is very important, that any BH curve in front of you, you have to analyze it. And supposedly this is given to you also as a question, that okay, find out mu R at three different points. So based on those three different points, you can easily use this formula and you can find out your mu R at all different points over there. So you are going to get the maximum here, then a little increase, decrease, and then a little decrease at this point. So now if I plug in the answer over here, so from here my H max comes out to be, so H max from the curve, GG beta. 1.8 means that now your value of current which you are going to take is going to be very high. So when the current is going to be very high, your copper losses are going to increase. I square R losses, because current is being squared over there. Plus, it's not an energy efficient device. Pehle kya ho raha tha? Supposingly, aap kehte ho ji 1.5 Tesla pe aap design kar rahe the. And okay, so I say, okay, yaar, there is a increase of 0.3 Tesla. It's a huge increase. Main apna area kam kar sakta hun. But the increase in the current is very huge. You are almost doubling it, 80-70%. So over here you can see, from just 36 ampere turns, you are going at something 200, 300, 400, something 500 ampere turns. So from 36 to 500, it's almost 10 times increase in your H value. And what is H value? H is equal to Ni divided by Lc. N is not changing, Lc is not changing. The only thing changing is I. So your current is increasing over there. So from this value of H, you have 36 ampere turns over here per meter. This is your H over here. So using this equation, now I can find out I max. I max is going to be equal to H max into Lc divided by N. H is 36 into Lc. Lc, we have just found it out. It was 0.7112. So this is 0.7112 divided by 200. Please, anyone with calculator? हाँ जी. आप कोर को छोटा करते जाओगे, that is good. But अगर आपने 200 turns करनी है, कितनी छोटी आप कोर कर सकते हो? So they are like, it's a trade-off. Every time I told you already from the very first lecture, that whenever you are designing an electromechanical device or something, a magnetic device, you have to have a trade-off. Either you have to reduce down the size of the magnetic circuit, or you have to reduce down the size of your electrical circuit, which is the windings. ठीक है? So, जी, answer please, IMAX. 0.128. And I hope anyone has a Fitzgerald with you. You will see that there are some approximations done in over here. They have given an answer of 0.13 amperes. So please write down the exact answers whenever you're getting. Don't approximate them, otherwise it's going to be difficult for you. Okay, the third thing which is asked over here in this question, which is very important again, RMS exciting current, which means that what is the RMS current over here which is exciting the core. Now, what this is very important. Don't confuse it with your second value of peak current. That was a total current going inside the core that was having a peak value corresponding to that B. Now, the third part or C part, that is RMS exciting current, this is that exciting current, if you remember it, the curve we saw in the last lecture that was corresponding to VA per kilogram. And that VA per kilogram, if I can show you, I guess that curve, that equation is still here. I told you at that time, this was the equation. Okay, and this one was over here, this one. This one was your exciting RMS voltampere. So you multiplied your RMS value by your current RMS value, and then you divided by your mass over there. This one was PA, and this PA was going to tell you that what is the value over here. For certainly what value of B, you are going to get what value of VA per kilogram. So for this one, if I go back on over there, the question asked is this, what is the RMS? Now, corresponding to this curve over here, I know my point is 1.5 Tesla. So if you see over here, this is exactly at the center over there. So this is 1 and 2 over here, and then 3, and then 4 and 5. Now you can take it 1.6 or 1.7. Again, this is totally a human error how you are seeing the graph. Over here in the book, they have taken this one as 1.5 VA per kilogram. Now, to find out 1.5 VA per kilogram, any question? You are hitting the hand. So 1.5 VA per kilogram, you are being told that if you have 1 kilogram of the material, you are going to get 1.5 VA. Now, I still don't know the kilograms of my core. I only know the mean length. I know the cross-sectional area. For this purpose, I need to go back on my diagram and see what is the volume of my core. Okay? Gee, what is the volume of the core? How am I going to find out the volume of my core? And one thing very important, I have been told that mass density is equal to 7.65 grams per centimeter cube. Now, since the mass density is given in centimeter cube, it's better you convert your volume into something centimeter cube. Or you change your mass density into meter cube so that it's easy for you to solve. This is very important. I'm an example because this example is actually like the most important example from Fitzgerald. And it almost covers all the examples or end problems of this chapter. So 7.65 grams per centimeter cube. And if you see this curve over here, this LC is equal to 0.7112 meters. The cross-sectional area is 4 square inches. So I can use 28 inches multiplied by 4 square inches as the volume in inches. So what this means that if I go back over here, the first thing first, I want to find out the volume. So the volume of my core is going to be equal to 4 square inch, and this will be actually equal to the cross-sectional area multiplied by LC. Simple, go back to your diagram. It's a uni cross-sectional circuit, which means the area of cross-section is same. So here it's also 4, here it's also 4. The length is 28 inches. So if you just take it, it is approximately 28 inches multiplied by the cross-sectional area. Aapko volume chahiye na? If you want to find out the volume, aapko kya chahiye hoga? Aap pehle is region ki aap volume nikaloge. Phir isi tarah se aap is region ka nikaloge. Phir then is region ka nikaloge. And then afterwards you are going to find out this one. Now instead of finding out separately, elongate all this one into one bar. This bar is actually a length of 28 inches and the cross-sectional area is 4 square inches. So 28 multiplied by 4, that is the area, volume of your core over here. Got it? So this is going to be 4 square inches into 28 square inches. This is square, but that is not inches, that is going to be just inches. So the volume of the core becomes equal to, now I want to convert this one into over here. So this will be 4 into 28 into 0.94. 0.94, again the stacking factor coming into play. The actual iron, okay? 0.94, how much iron I have over there, telling me that the 6% is lost over there. So this is going to give me, please, anyone with answer, please. 28. So this is square inches over here. So this is my volume. Now here, next thing, I need to find out weight. This is in square inches, so this means 105.28, and I'm going to multiply this one by something, 2.54 centimeter cube, and multiplied by this. And since I know what is the value from here, that is 7.65 grams per centimeter cube. So this one would be 7.65 grams per centimeter cube. Something like this. Okay with this? Converting your inches into centimeters, 2.54 centimeter cube. You have to cube it. Please give me the answer. Kiss me? Oh, yes, sorry. Yes, you are right. Exactly right. Sorry. Thank you. This will be, oh, not centimeter. This is inch cube. Right. Thank you. G, please give me the weight. 105.28 cubic inches, and then 2.54. You have to cube it. This is very important. Okay? So, this is something like this. Instead of writing centimeter, write it over there. G, please, someone with a calculator. 1.319. 10 raised to power 4. Now this will be in grams, okay, because you are getting in grams per centimeter. So now when you want to convert it, this will be equal to 13.19 into 10 raised to power 3 grams again, and now you can do it, 13.19 kilograms. So you have now your weight. Now from this curve, you found out that it was 1.5 VA per kilogram. So this means that now you want to find out PA. So your PA would be equal to 1.5 VA per kilogram multiplied by 13.19 kilograms. This will give you, please give me the answer. 1.5 multiplied by 13.19. 19.7, again 8. You see, anyone has the book with you, they have written directly 20 VA. Now 20 VA is a very big approximation from 19.78. So please, in your exams, do not do this approximation. Please always write the exact answer so that it can be compared. G. VA? PA is the exciting RMS volt ampere. I just told you this one is PA. Exciting RMS over here, and this is given from this table. You are working at 1.5, so you take this one over here like this. This is your 1.5 and like this. So this is between 1 and 2, so I'm taking at 1.5 VA per kilogram. Okay, so this is the same thing I have taken over here in this graph also. Same thing. Wo pichle lecture mein tha, yes lecture mein se. Okay, so you have PA, but the question asked in C part, if you see over here, the question asked was RMS exciting current. So what was PA? PA has been found as 19.78. So what has been asked is I phase RMS. And what was I phase RMS? If I go back over here on this curve, I phase RMS was equal to, over here, PA equal to this force divided by the mass. So if I need to find out now this quantity over here, I phase RMS, if I go back over here, this I phase RMS will be equal to PA divided by E phase RMS. And what is your PA? PA is 19.78. What is EA? ई ए क्या है? दिस इज ई, सॉरी डोंट, दिस इज ई फेज बिकॉज ऑफ द स्पेस आई हैव. जी कोई बताएगा व्हाट इज ई फेज? भाई अप्लाइड वोल्टेज है और हमने अभी ए पार्ट के अंदर ये चीज निकाली थी, योर ई ए वॉज इक्वल टू दिस वैल्यू. नाउ दिस इज अ मैक्सिमम वैल्यू गिविंग यू 274.35. नाउ यू हैव बीन आस्क्ड दैट व्हाट इज ई फेज आर एम एस. सो दिस विल बी इक्वल टू ई पीक मल्टीप्लाइड बाय 0.707. इट्स अ साइन वेव. सो दिस मीन्स दिस विल बी इक्वल टू 274.35 multiplied by 0.707. So this means if I go back over there, 274.35, over here this will be 274.35 multiplied by 0.707. Please give me the current. Please understand this numerical. I'm spending time on this one because this is very much important. A part is dependent on B. B. 0.102 amperes. Now you can see this current is coming out to be 0.102 amperes. ये exciting current है. The previous current you found out in B part was 0.128. Now what you are getting from this? Can anyone tell me? This was the maximum current. You have to first of all convert into its RMS value or whatever. This current is being used by the winding. Total current over there. This one over here is the RMS current of 0.102 amperes. Can anyone tell me what is the difference in these two? Ji, this is I phase RMS. This one is 0.128 amperes. Kya fark hai in dono mein? Saturation ki to baat hi nahi keh rahe hum yahan pe. We are having a BH curve and we are almost operating below the saturation curve. Ji, come on. We have spent a lot amount of time on the equivalent circuit of a transformer. Ji, anyone? Ye abhi core loss nahi hai. If you remember your transformer equivalent circuit, let me draw that again. If your transformer equivalent circuit is the questioning, this one was the primary. And in parallel, there were two elements. One was called as this one, and then there was an ideal transformer. Now, in this case, since there is no secondary winding, so technically speaking, this curve, this part is not there. There is no secondary winding. There is no ideal transformation taking place. So the only thing over here is this, that you have a source, and that source, this is your RP, this is JXP, this is RC, this is JXC. Where is my current going? Come on, give me an answer on this one. The exciting RMS volt ampere, as I told you, are the power VA being used by your inductor so that there is a core flux flowing over there. And in the current which is going to flow inside RC is going to be the core losses that are used in hysteresis and eddy current losses. And for that hysteresis current losses, the D part is there. And what is D part? If I go back on the statement over here, the D part is the core loss. And for core loss, I have to use another curve, which I told you at that time is going to be called as PC. This is PC, that is watts per kilogram. But dekho, there is a resistor involved. And I told you in the last lecture that resistor uses active power P. So that's why it is written as watts per kilogram. The previous curve over here was using VA per kilogram. This was being used by the inductor. Because an inductor, you are just multiplying V multiplied by I over there. So this is VA per kilogram. But over here, when you want to find out the loss, so you have to find out this PC. This comes out to be whatever its value. Over here, this is 1.5. So corresponding to this, this value, now it's totally up to you. Since this is 2, you have to take something over there. In your book, they have taken this one as 1.2 watts per kilogram. Even if you take 1.3, no issues with this. So now your PC over here is equal to 1.2 watts per kilogram. So this means if you need to find out your core loss, you have to multiply PC by the weight of your core. And what is weight of the core? We already have found it out, 13.19 kilograms. So this will be multiplied by 13.19. Please give me the answer. 1.2 multiplied by 13.19. 15.8 watts. This is your core losses. Let me call it not this one. This is your core losses. Now I'm leaving a question to you. Most probably in the next lecture I will ask for you. This RMS current is 0.102 amperes. Okay? This maximum current is 0.12 amperes over here. Okay? You can convert it into its RMS equivalent by multiplying by 0.707. You have to answer me and tell me what are the values of current here, what are the values of current here, what are the values of current here. I'm again leaving. Telling you, you have to tell me this IP current, you have to tell me this current of IH plus E, and you have to tell me this current of IM or I phase. आपके पास दो करंट्स मौजूद हैं. यू हैव बिन टोल्ड ओवर हेयर आई फेज आर एम एस द एक्साइटेशन आर एम एस करंट ओवर हेयर दैट इज 0.102 एम्पियर्स एंड यू हैव बिन टोल्ड द मैक्सिमम करंट फ्लोइंग इन साइड द वाइंडिंग 0.128. हाँ जी, आई पी नहीं, ये आर एम एस वैल्यूज हैं. प्लीज, वन थिंग वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, वेन एवर एन इक्विवेलेंट सर्किट इज ड्रॉन, दिस करंट they all are RMS. And assuming they are sinusoidal. अगर वो sinusoidal नहीं है then that's a different story. But overall, assuming that they are all sinusoidal. ठीक है, think on it and answer me on this one. What is IH plus E? What is IM? This is also called as I phase. Same thing, no issue. Then what is IP? And certainly IP will be equal to this current plus this current sum. But you have to tell me IP also. You have to tell me I phase and IH plus E. What are their values? The any ambiguity with this question? This is a very important question. This is actually example number 1.8, which I've just solved over here, since you have all the values over there. Ji, any question? Haan ji. Technically, if you do it from the unit-wise, certainly nothing. But since VA is the power used to flow a core flux, और जो वो वॉट्स हैं वो एडी करंट और हिस्टेरेसिस में लॉस हो रहे हैं, उनके यूनिट्स वॉट्स होंगे क्योंकि वो रजिस्टर से रिप्रेजेंट हो रहे हैं. बट द वीए वो कहाँ खर्च हो रहा है, कितना करंट चाहिए मल्टीप्लाइड बाय द वोल्टेज, दैट इज द पावर यूज्ड टू हैव अ कोर फ्लक्स फ्लोइंग ओवर देयर. अगर ये मटीरियल ऐसा होता, फॉर एग्जाम्पल यहाँ पे इसकी रिलक्टेंस वॉज समथिंग जीरो एंड दिस वॉज गोइंग टू इन्फिनिटी, तो हमें यहाँ पे कोई वीए खर्च नहीं होना था हमारा. As soon as there is a current flow, there is nothing, no VA required. But this mu R is not infinity. It is having some reluctance. So it is opposing some force. Wo force humse yahan pe ek power kharch karwa rahi hai, that is VA per kilogram. But there is a eddy current flowing over here in this direction. Certainly it is being minimized by the emanations, but it's still there. Maybe in one lamination it is there, maybe in another lamination is there. Plus the hysteresis loss. So that has been combined together as your PC over here, that is the core loss, 1.2 watts per kilogram. And you can see very clearly from this example that if you go on a higher value of, like supposing you take a value of 1.8, so you are going to get 2 watts per kilogram. There is almost an 80% increase or 90% increase in your value. So using a larger B means that you are going to have larger losses inside your core. Okay, coming on to the next thing, which is very important. Any questions? Anyone else having a question? Okay, now this discussion is very important. This discussion is related to permanent magnets. We all know we have been using permanent magnets to either maybe stick something on your fridge or anywhere else, and or even as a toy or something like that. I have shown over here in this curve, as you can see, two materials. One is called as the Alnico 5, and other one is called as M5 silicon steel sheet. which is the same which we have used in the last example. This pink color curve or purple color curve over here is that for M5. This black color one is El Niño 5. Can anyone tell me, based on just seeing the curve, which material should I use, El Niño or M5? I have to use them inside a circuitry which is having no excitation. Please remember, this all discussion, whichever I am going to do now, is based on no excitation. What I mean by no NI, no MMF is there. This is zero. There is no winding. There is no current flowing over there. Which means whenever aap ek lohe ke saath, fridge ke saath, diffuser ke saath ek magnet laga dete ho, whatever, magnet apni magnetism ki wajah se wahan pe chipka hua hai. So question over here, first of all, for first question, El Niño 5 or M5, dono mein se behtar kaun sa hai? And this is the second quadrant. One thing very important, this is the second quadrant of your BH curve. If I draw this one, certainly El Niño 5 will be having a more hysteresis loss if I take a whole curve. M5 over on the whole is going to have a less hysteresis loss. But here hysteresis loss is not under question. Why? Because hysteresis loss comes into play when you are AC exciting the core. Aap usko positive current bhi de rahe ho, negative current bhi de rahe ho. Then hysteresis loss comes into play. Now at present, you are not applying any current over there. It's a no excitation circuit. Which means that I have something, a circuit like this. Now what is this circuit? Over here, this material, if you see very closely, this material over here is that magnetic material, El Niño 5 or El Niño or N5 over there. This material over here, like this one and this one, I am assuming for now that it's an infinite permeability material. And then inside this air gap, I have to take its magnetism out. So first of all, answer me this question, which is better, El Niño 5 or M5? It's El Niño 5 actually, not El Niño only, it's El Niño 5. Let me just confirm it. This is El Niño 5, El Niño 5 actually is the name. Ji, anyone? Ji, from here. Ye dono mein se kaun sa better hai? Ji. Come on, give me an answer. Maybe a wrong one even, no issues. Ji. M5 kyun? Kya hai? Curve choti hone se kya hoga? Nahin, give me an answer, reason. Maybe a wrong one even, no problem. Kya hoga? Maine bhi bola, hysteresis curve is not an important over here. Hysteresis curve kab important hoti hai? When you have a curve, and you try to, supposedly, you take an M5 material, M5 is going to have something, a hysteresis curve like this. But hysteresis curve come into play when from this zero value of current, you go from zero to some high value of current over here, and then you go in the negative value of high value of current. But here in this circuit, there is no excitation. I is zero. क्यों? You are not applying any current. So there are two parameters you have to look for any material. One material is BR. One parameter, sorry, is BR. The other parameter is coercivity. Now what is BR? BR is called as remnant magnetization, which means you have made your current equal to zero. The material is still having magnetism. Now, M5 is not a permanent magnet, but it is exhibiting a BR of same value, which is over here in this case, 1.5 Tesla, approximately. It's not marked over here. I have this in the text. But the other thing which is important is coercivity. And over here, this value for a Niño 5 is 50 minus 50, minus because you have to apply it in negative. If this was a magnet, supposedly, let me see on this one. If this was a magnet, this was having a north pole and south pole, and on this north pole and south pole, you had a winding. So you are going to produce a flux inside it in such a way, let me call this one. Now you know, according to right hand rule, the flux is going to go out. Now you need to have a current flowing opposite to this one, so that there is a north pole created over here, south pole created over here. so that you demagnetize the magnetism inside it. So what this is telling you, you require an H of minus 50 kiloamperes per meter to actually make it zero. But in case of M5, this value is not even, it's only just equal to, it's not written over there, this is equal to minus 5 amperes per meter, not even kilo. Ye purple curve maine ispe emboss khud ki hai, so that it can be compared over there, otherwise it's not written in your book. So this minus 50 and minus 5, are they important? Yes, they are definitely important, because inside any circuitry, which is something like this. Now, in this circuitry, write down the magnetic circuit of this one. Now, you want to have a magnetic circuit on this one. What you will do, in this one, whenever you are going to convert any magnetic circuit into an electrical circuit, what you do, you first of all draw the NI. Then you have the material reluctance over there. Then you have the other material reluctance over there. Then the other. Now, in this case, over here, there is no NI. There is no winding. Plus, this material and this material has a reluctance of equal to zero. Because mu r is zero. Mu r is infinity. So, I have now only two reluctances in my circuit. One is of the material, or I can call it as the magnet. The other one is the air gap, that is Rg. So now, this circuit becomes equal to, if I draw it again, this circuit becomes equal to, just equal to having R and R like this. This is Rg, this is Rm. Now, write down the equation for this circuit. There will be some flux flowing over here. And assuming, just for now, I am assuming the cross-sectional area over here, area of the core and area of the air gap, they both are same. Just for now, because to make my life simple over there. Now, when you are going to write down the equation over here, that equation, koi batayega mujhe what will be the equation over here? For this one, this circuitry. Ji. Phi, again, sorry? Phi Rg plus? Plus Phi Rm. And what it will be equal to? Equal to zero? Yes, certainly it will be equal to zero. Now, they are, this means that this value and this value, one is going to be actually negative. So this means one is actually going to produce the flux, other one is going to use it. Listen this carefully. Since over here, these two quantities, they are going to add up equal to zero because there is no excitation. So this means that flux for one material is going to be produced, the other material is going to use it. Now, instead of writing this equation in this term, I know according to my Ampere's law, H is equal to Ni divided by Lc. Now, what is this? If I rearrange this one, Ni can be called as H dot Lc. Agreed? And what is Ni? Ni is the magnetomotive force over here. So now, what was this equation based on? This equation was based on magnetomotive force equal to the magnetomotive force on this side plus the magnetomotive force on this side. So I can write this equation now in terms of this equation. So this means the net MMF, which is equal to zero, equal to H dot LC. Now what is H? H for the material multiplied by the length of that material, then H of the air gap multiplied by the length of the air gap. So this means my equation would be HM dot LM plus HG dot G. Got this equation? I have used Ampere's law. H was equal to Ni by Lc. So Lc gone over here. So I have Ni equal to H dot Lc. So in any magnetic circuit, your Ampere turns are going to be equal to H dot Lc. Now in this circuitry, over here, my combined Ni is zero. So this means that H dot Lc of this circuitry and H dot Lc of this circuitry, they both are going to cancel each other. So over here, the equation is HMLM plus HG into G. Now, using this relation, I can write now this relation over here. This is HM dot LM plus HG dot G is equal to 0. So from here, I have HG. I can take this on the other side. So this is minus HM LM divided by D. And this is my equation. In fact, let me add another page over here because this is going to take some time. G, HG is equal to, I have this relation. Let me call this relation as equation A. Now, as I told you in the very start, that the area of the core and the area of the air gap, they both are same. So this means that since this is a series circuit, the value of flux flowing from one end to the other, they both are same. So the flux inside the air gap and the flux inside the material, they both are same because they both have almost the same cross-sectional area also, and there is no excitation source. So this phi g will be equal to AG into BG, and sorry, this will not going to be equal, this will be equal to, and this will be equal to AM into BM. So I have this relation, and I can now write down BG equal to AM divided by AG into BM. So I have now this another relation. Now here in this my case, I made it equal area. I made it equal area. So this can be cancelled over here. But I am not, I'm making it a general statement over here. So I'm calling it as equation number B. So now what I have two equations. One equation is this one, another one is equal to this one over here. Now, is there any way I can solve it for a value of BG somehow? G, can I solve it for BG? What I want, I actually want that I need to find out the air gap density. Kya karte? BG की जगह mu not h BG is going to be equal to, you are saying it that if I have it over here, BG is going to be equal to mu not hg, like this. Anything else which I can do over here? Anything else? I need to find out either BG or either BM. I need to find out BG or BM. They both will be same in our case because area is the same. Okay? Because flux is the same, area is the same. So I can either use this one or either I can use that one. So over here, if I use this one, this is going to be BG equal to mu naught. And what is AG? AG is equal to minus HM into that is LM over G. G, can I solve it still? मेरे पास HM भी नहीं है. हाँ बोलो. देखो नहीं मैं इसी के what he told me, actually I'm trying to use that. What I have done over here, I have one equation over here as this. ठीक है जी. I have got it from the magnetomotive force equation. So I have HG equal to minus HM LM over G, and I have another equation based on that the flux flowing in the air gap is equal to the flux flowing in from the material. So AG into BG is equal to AG AM into MM. What is M? M is the material or the magnet over here in this case. So using this BG equal to this one, this is equal to AM over AG into BM. So I have now two relations. This is B, this is A. What I want to find out, I need to find out either BG or BM. Now he proposed me that okay, I can use BG equal to mu naught HG. So I put it BG equal to mu naught minus HM into LM over G. Now I don't know what is HM. Kiske saath? Okay, I have an HM over here. So this means I can take my HM over here equal to, this will be minus HG into G over LM. From here? So this means I can call it C equation, and I can now put in over here. So B G will be equal to mu naught into जी, ये उसी क्वेश्चन में वही वापस डाले जा रहे हैं, ये जो करवा रहा है ना मेरे से वैसली। हाँ जी, हाँ अब आए सेकेंड इक्वेशन। सेकेंड इक्वेशन में क्या है ये देखना चाह रहा हूँ, सो रहे हैं सारे या कोई जवाब आ रहा है कि नहीं आएगा। अच्छा You have BG equal to mu naught AG. Now tell me what you have to do. I need to find out DG and BM. बताओ वो क्या कह रहे थे? कमाल है। I am asking for BG and BM. You have to either give me BG or BM. BM निकाल दो या BG निकाल दो, whatever. How I can find out BM? You have two relations over here. One relation is this. One relation is this. ओ भाई एक ही चीज है, बीजी कर लो या बीएम कर लो, दोनों बोथ आर सेम इन आवर केस बिकॉज द एरिया इज सेम। किस में इक्वेशन ए है हमारे पास, क्या करें इसमें? एल जी की वैल्यू, एच जी की वैल्यू, हाँ इधर डाल दें। ओके सो यू आर सेइंग आई कैन पुट दिस एच जी वैल्यू इनसाइड ओवर हेयर, सो इफ आई टेक दिस सेकेंड इक्वेशन I know BG is equal to AM over AG into BM. So BG will be equal to mu naught HG equal to AM over AG into BM. So you are saying I put HG from that equation over here. ठीक है? So this will be equal to mu naught into what is the value? This is minus HM into that is LM. Yes, LM over G equal to AM over AG into BM. जी यहां से क्या लेना है मुझे अब? BM निकालना है। So what is going to be BM? Please anyone. Minus mu naught LM over G into AG over AM multiplied by HM. This is your final equation over here. Any ambiguity with this? Okay. In this equation, now listen to this very, very carefully. BM, material magnetic field density, which in our case will be equal to BG. Minus mu naught value is known. LM and G ki values aapke paas available hain. AG or AM ki values aapke paas available hain. If they are equal, certainly they will cancel each other. The only thing not available is BHM over here. Now, what is this equation? Is this a BH curve equation? What is this? कोई मुझे बताएगा? अगर मैं इस equation को on a graph paper plot करना चाहूँ, what will be the shape of this equation? भाई, what is HM? HM is on the x-axis and HM is going to increase when the current is going to increase. So this means this equation is going to be a straight line equation. I'm again repeating. You are finding out BM based on HM. Ye sare values constants hain. Ye sare values constants hain. Mu naught, LM, G, AG, AM, they all are constants for any given circuit. HM is increasing. HM is dependent upon some DC current flowing over there. So whatever that. And BM is going to be the output. So when you are going to plot this on a BH curve, let me plot this one over here on this side. So if I have this one, I have B over here and H over here. Where this equation will be plotted? G. First quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, fourth. Second quadrant. It will be something aligned with this slope. Because it's negative. It's going to have a negative slope. Now this curve will be plotted from some zero value to some value of HM over there. And this curve is shown over here in this example as a load line over here. I'm again repeating. That equation of BM or BG, whatever you have over there, is shown over here as a straight line for values from zero to whatever value you want to plot it. So this is going to give you BM or BG, and it will be a straight line, and this straight line, wherever it intersects, this point is going to be your working BM or BG. I am again repeating. You got this relation over here, this one. This one. This relation is a straight line equation. So you are now going to solve it graphically by plotting it on a graph paper with your BH curve and the point it intersects over here like this. That is going to be the working point of your material. What I mean by working point, this BM or BG, if they are both are same, certainly in our case, because the area is same, then this two will be having this much BM or BG. If you are using Alnico 5, it is intersecting at this point, you will be adding approximately something 0.3 Tesla. You will do it graphically. It's not a mathematical problem. Remember it. It's a graphical problem now. So you have the BH curve, you will plot it, and where it intersects, this will be giving you 0.3 Tesla. But on the same end, it is intersecting over here with M5 material at a very small point, and that value is 3.8 into 10 raised to power minus 5 Tesla. What this is telling you? This is telling you that the material coercivity tells you that your magnet is going to give you how much flux in your circuitry, and that is certainly dependent upon the area of the cross section, the length of your material, the length of the air gap. Why? Because if you see this equation, which I have just over here, what is over here? Mu naught is a constant, no need of doing anything. Lm, length of the material. G, length of the air gap. Ag, air cross-sectional area of the air gap. Am, the area of the material. If they both are same, certainly they both will cancel each other, and then you just have Hm and then Bm over there. So first of all, you are going to plot this on your material BH curve, and when you have plotted it, you are going to get these two points over there. One is having 0.3 Tesla, the other one is having 3.8 into 10 raised to power minus 5 Tesla. Now, if you are seeing this curve, can you tell me from which point you should have your material B? This is easily telling you, if you wanted a more B from your material, your curve should be intersecting somewhere here. If the load line example was going over here like this, then it would be intersecting over here at this point. So you would be getting something near about like 0.9 Tesla or something like this. Now, how you are going to change this load line? You are going to change it by changing your length of the material. Yahan kya ho raha hai? This curve and this curve, they both are having different slopes. And how the slopes are being changed? The slopes are being changed because of Lm over G and Ag over Am. Supposingly area is same, that is not our consider. Lm, length of material badega, slope badegi. When slope is going to be more and area air gap is going to be more, this curve will have more slope. And a point may come that you can have a curve even intersecting like this. So you are going to get something maybe like 1.3 Tesla. So higher the value of your, zyada bada magnet hai, zyada bada lengthwise magnet hai, you are going to get more flux out of it. Now, the important thing, hum slope badhai ja rahe hain, hum magnet bade se bada karte ja rahe hain, cross sectional area uska same hai because humare material ka same hai. This is line supposedly called as A, B and C. Out of A, B and C, effective kaun sa hai zyada? I'll just wrap it up in just like 4-5 minutes, so just let me do it. Ji. C? C is effective? C pe toh humare paas Tesla hi bahut kaam aa rahe hai, 0.3 Tesla. B, why? Why? Now, which thing is deciding? Which is the most effective? It is being decided by the value of BM and the value of HM your circuit is having. Here, when you are operating your material at point B, you are going to have the area under the curve at this much area. Agreed? But if you are operating at point A, supposingly, let me use another color for this one. So you are going to get something like this, and this will be your area of the curve. So when you are going to intersect at point A, like this, or if you are operating, let me just choose another one, maybe some blue color over here, and you are operating at this point, so you will be getting something . So you have three curves, A, B, and C. Which is the highest area under the curve? B. So this point over here is called as the maximum energy product, because here you are multiplying BM by HM. You are getting the area. Yahan pe aapke paas agar aapka operating point hai, you are getting 0.9 Tesla. You are getting something 44 or 42 something kilo amperes per meter H. So BM and HM, they are energy density units. So this B color curve or B point curve is the maximum product you can take out from your material. जी. देखो working point कैसे change हो रहा था. अभी हम इसके वापस आते हैं इस question पे. हमारे पास the length of magnet change हो रहा है, तो operating point की slope change हो रही है. So this is telling me अगर मेरे area दोनों same है, ये दोनों cancel out हो रहे हैं, तो मैं length of magnet ऐसा रखूं कि मेरे पास स्लोप कम्स आउट टू बी नियर दिस बी पॉइंट और बी कर्व. सो आई एम गोइंग टू गेट द मैक्सिमम एरिया अंडर द कर्व. नाउ व्हाई दिस इज इंपॉर्टेंट, सी दिस वन प्रूफ, आई हैव डन दिस वन ओवर हियर फॉर दिस. यू नीड टू फाइंड आउट दैट व्हाट इज द वॉल्यूम ऑफ योर मैग्नेट. नाउ यू हैव यूज्ड अ लेंथ ऑफ मटीरियल दैट इज सर्टनली हैविंग अ लेंथ एम एंड क्रॉस सेक्शनल एरिया ए एम. सो यू नीड टू फाइंड आउट द वॉल्यूम ऑफ द मैग्नेट. यानी कि आपका मकसद ये है कि यू हैव टू फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज द ऑप्टिमम वैल्यू ऑफ वॉल्यूम ऑफ मैग्नेट व्हिच विल गिव यू द ऑप्टिमम वैल्यू ऑफ बी फ्रॉम दैट मटेरियल. फॉर दिस पर्पस यू ऑलरेडी नो योर बी जी इज इक्वल टू ए एम डिवाइड बाय ए जी इनटू बी एम ऑलरेडी फ्रॉम द लास्ट ओवर देयर. एंड यू ऑल्सो नो फ्रॉम द प्रीवियस वन एच एम एल एम इज इक्वल टू ए जी इनटू जी माइनस वन फॉर द माइनस साइन ओवर देयर. सो यू हैव इक्वेशन ए एंड बी. नाउ यूजिंग इक्वेशन नंबर बी You have AG equal to minus HM LG over here. This is equation number C taken up from equation number B over here. So multiplying this by mu naught. Why we are multiplying it by mu naught? Because you have AG. So AG multiplied by mu naught kya hoga? Bhai air gap hai. Air gap ke AG ko mu naught se multiply karenge, you will get BG. So this will be BG equal to mu naught AG multiplying this by, this equation is now minus mu naught HM LM over G. Now this is equation number D. Okay? Now this is equal to BG, and you also know BG is equal to this equation. Now equation number A, equation number D, they both are exactly equal on the left hand side. So what I am going to do, I am going to multiply equation A and D. So what I get now, I have BG square equal to this equation minus mu naught AM divided by AG, LM divided by G multiplied by BM and HM. Now what is AM into LM? Volume of my magnet. Area of the magnet, LM the length of the magnet. AG into G, area of the air gap into the air gap length over there. So what I have now, BG square equal to minus mu naught into volume of my magnet divided by the volume of the air gap multiplied by BM and HM. Now this BM and HM is same coming on from the last discussion, that this product of BM and HM, if it is going to be higher, so if I rearrange this equation, what I have now, volume of my magnet is equal to volume of the air gap divided by mu naught into minus HM BM into BG square. Now supposingly aap ek circuit design kar rahe ho, you require a BG of supposingly 1.0 Tesla. Now, you need to have the smallest size of magnet. So, you will require the highest value of BMHM. And highest value of BMHM is over here in this curve at this point, because the yellow color area is the maximum over here under the curve. अगर आप सी पॉइंट लेते हो, सॉरी ए पॉइंट लेते हो, द एरिया ऑफ द वैल्यूज ऑफ बी एम एंड एच एम आर स्मॉल. बी आर बी एम बड़ा है लेकिन एच एम बहुत थोड़ा है. सिमिलरली इफ यू गो विद द सी पॉइंट यू हैव अ स्मॉलर वैल्यू ऑफ बी एम बट एच एम इज क्वाइट लार्ज. द ओनली पॉइंट विच इज गिविंग यू द हाइएस्ट प्रोडक्ट ऑफ बी एम एंड एच एम इज दिस पॉइंट बी. सो फॉर एनी मटीरियल यू वॉन्ट टू यूज एज अ मैग्नेट द वैल्यूम ऑफ द मैग्नेट इज इनवर्सली प्रोपोर्शनल टू this value of HM, BM that you want to use over there. And don't confuse yourself with this negative sign over here. This negative sign is because the HM is negative. Aap HM ki value isme daloge formula mein, HM would be automatically becoming negative, negative, positive. So the volume of magnet you are going to get is going to be a minimum value if you use HM and BM at the maximum point. Okay. Please kindly go through this one and the associated example number 1.10 over here. This is very much important. Example number 1.10 from your the Fitzgerald book. So this is very much important over here. This is actually I wanted to do this, but there is not much time available over here now. So please kindly go through this one.